I hope you can hear me. I'm going to talk a little bit about parallel STL and how you can get today parallel STL using SQL. I work for Cope Software. We work in compilers and runtimes and all these kind of things. We're mainly working on SQL, the new Chrome standard. And one of the main things that we want to do is to create an ecosystem of applications around SQL to promote the use of the language. But one of the main focus of SQL is to get as close as possible to the new SQL standard. So in Kronos, we are working on keeping track of all the things that are going on the standards. I'm working with Microworm here. We are trying to get things also from the standard back to Kronos. And one of the things that we are taking back from the standard to Kronos is the idea of the parallel STL. So we have chosen to implement the C++ NFT proposal using SQL because it's the easiest way that you can get to a GPU today using modern C++ in a very easy to use interface. Okay? So I'm going to explain you a little bit about the parallel STLs. I'm going to then explain you how we do it in SQL and what some things that we have done with it. Okay? And I have a lot of slides, but I'm going to be very quick and fast so we can get to the coffee and the beer quite fast. Okay? Okay, so as I said, my name is Omar Reyes. I've been working in HPC for a long time. I've done Scala, Scalapack, Gromax. I've done my share of Fortran, OpenMP, a lot of these things. I quit and I now work with Cope, runtimes and C++ for some reason. I'm contributing to the SQL specification. I'm working with Michael on some proposals for the C++ standard. I'm the lead of CompuCP, which is the SQL implementation that we are working in CompuCP. I'm also the coordinator of the SQL parallel STL for Kronos. So I'm normally monitoring the GitHub repo and taking a look to the merge request and all the work that people is doing on it. Cope Software is a software shop. We are based in Edinburgh. We have now 57 people, not 42. We are growing a lot. We have all kind of people working for us. We have people from HPC like me, but we also have people from games technologies, people from artificial intelligence. We have people also different levels, graduates, PhD students. We have all kinds of people working for us. We have customers in all kinds of areas of industry. We work mainly for semiconductor companies, but we also do all kinds of contract work, and we work in all sort of crazy and very interesting projects that are always confidential, so we cannot talk about them. Cool, so let's talk a little bit about parallel STL. So this is a set of proposals that have been going on for a long time. All the different vendors started working on different ways of getting an easy way to get to the GPU for the common algorithm. So since like Thrust from NVIDIA, which has been for a long time, implements reductions, implements C++ interface to get to the NVIDIA hardware. Then Bolt, which is the NVIDIA counterpart, they say, that gives you also some patterns from C++, that is based mostly on OpenCL and now on XSA. And all of these different vendors were working on their own things, and they all tried to get these things into the C++ standard now a couple of years ago. So all of them, they came with different proposals. NVIDIA came with a proposal based on Thrust. Microsoft and Intel, they gathered together, they presented a different proposal, and all of the committee came back and said, okay, you guys sort it out together among yourselves and come with a unified proposal, because we are not going to do this. So they made a new proposal, and it has been going on in SE1 and SE14 and all the work we do for many years. And after all these years of work and gathering together and decide what goes in and what goes out, now it has been accepted for C++ 17 during Jacksonville. And it is now the C++ draft. So if you want to see the latest advancement, you can just get a C++ draft from the GitHub of the ISO committee, download it and read it, and you can see all the latest status of the things. Or you can ask Michael as well, but he was in the meeting and he knows everything about it. So there are various implementations. So Microsoft has an implementation, was the one of the first ones. HPX has also an implementation, so Michael was talking about it as well. There is an implementation in HSA, so the AMD is working on their own parallel STL interface. There are some open source ones in GitHub, NVIDIA. Based on Thrust, they have also an interface with policies. And in CodePlay, through Kronos, we are working on the SQL parallel STL one. Okay? So what is a parallel DS adding? I mean, if you look at the history of the proposal, this has been changing a lot. But what they have been focusing, and it has never actually changed since the beginning, is the fact that there are execution policies. And that's the main idea that allows you to choose where and how to execute your parallel algorithms and which device do you want to do it. So they have defined this thing that is called an execution policy, and then they have defined how to run some algorithms in parallel using these policies, and how to, and new algorithms that only make sense for parallel environments. Okay? And then at some point there was an exception list class that got dropped because of what Michael was saying before. But we still have it on the SQL Parallel STL because we do have exception list on SQL. So I'll get that into that a little bit in a couple of minutes. So I don't know if you can see it from there, but this is what you have been using for C++ for a long time. You do a std sort, you sort your data, everything works, okay? There's nothing fancy here. Now, how do you do it in parallel? You add the policy, you do std par, and this is running now in parallel. And you don't have to worry about anything else, okay? Because the standard gives you some guarantees on how this is going to be executed, and if they, for whatever reason, the std algorithm that you want to use doesn't cannot be parallelized, then the compiler should not be doing parallelized. Okay? And this is now in the C++17 standard, so most of the compilers will implementation of C++ will give you some kind of std parallel policy that will just work. Okay? So this part thing that we see here is an object, an instance of execution policy. And that's one of the standards execution policy. Okay? And that only means that the sort will run in parallel. Okay. I realize that it's too slow, too small, but it's only the screen we have. Okay. So there are different execution policies. I have been updating these slides after Michael told me what happened on the meeting. So now they are called. You have a sequential policy, which means that explicitly you don't want to do anything in parallel. This is going to be explicitly sequential. I will see why we need that in a couple of slides. You have a parallel policy, which means that it can do things in parallel. It doesn't have to, but it can spawn threads with it. And you have a parallel and sequence policy, which used to be called the vector policy, the vector or vectorized policy, which allows you to not only run things in parallel, but also to run vectorization. So the algorithm that you're running can be vectorized in parallel. Okay? And then you can choose which one you want to do, and you can just call par and sec or sequence it, and then you can choose which algorithm you have to do, and you can compose this in libraries, and you can have a templated parameter in your library that is the policy that you want to use, and you can just pass the policy around, so the user can give you the policy that they want to use. You can use the template deduction to have different variants for different policies if you want. There are traits that you can use to detect which policy are you using, or if it is a policy or not. But, and here's the reason that you have the sequenced, if you are a library implementer and you want to run, make sure that something does not run in parallel, you can always use a sequenced policy to make sure that something is not going to be run in parallel. So that's the reason that you have a sequenced one. Okay? So what's happening is that because we are running things in parallel, there is a chance that if we get an error, we are going not just to get one error, but every single thread is going to throw an exception. So the original idea was that you will have an exception list that will give you that will capture all the exceptions that was happening, and then you can just go through this exception list and process the different exceptions. This has come to various problems, and the people say that having a list of exceptions is not useful, and it can be problematic to implement, and can be problematic to use. So now the behavior that is placed in C++17 is going to be just a terminate, so it's just going to stop. However, because in SQL we do have exception lists, we have means of dealing with them, because we have been doing this in OpenCV for a long time, we have implemented this exception list, and we keep it now, because it's associated with the policy, with the SQL policy that I will show you later. Okay. So this is the list of all the parallel algorithms. This is all the algorithms that were there before, and some new ones. So there are things that you can just do in parallel, so you can do a copy of two vectors in parallel, you can do a replace, you can do, there are basic algorithms that are in the STL, you can just run it in parallel. But there are also new algorithms, like the transform reduce or the reduce itself, that only make sense when you run in parallel, and they have been added to the C++17 standard. So this is one of the things that they have. They have a for each algorithm that allows you to run in parallel a functor for every single item of an iterating branch. That you can do it sequentially. Doesn't make much sense sequentially because that's a for loop basically. But in parallel, if you specify the policy, it means that you can run it in a GPU, in a CPU, in any kind of device. Okay. We have an accumulate. So in sequencer we have accumulate, but in parallel, in addition to accumulate, we have a reduce, which means that you don't have to be aware, you don't care about the order because the operators are associative and commutative. You can execute in any order, so you can have much more parallelism. And there are much more things. You have exclusive and inclusive scan, you have transform reduce, and many algorithms that are the basic foundation for many parallel operations, and you can just use the STD, the standard template library, just to use them. Which is really cool, because you can build things on top of this, and the C++ standard guarantees that these things are going to be there. So what do we have done with SQL? So we have created this SQL parallel STL, and we introduced two execution policies, okay? So how do you use it? You get what we have before as a sequencer sort. If we want to run in the GPU, the only thing you have to do is to use the SQL policy. So you pass a SQL policy, and it is not a standard policy, it's a SQL policy for various reasons. And that means that this sort is going to be executed on the GPU using SQL, okay? And you don't have to do anything else. Now, SQL policy is an execution policy. SQL policy is not a standard execution policy, and the reason is that SQL 1.2 is built on top of OpenCL 1.2, and there are some restrictions in terms of hardware and pointers and things we can do, and we cannot really match what C++ 17 is giving for the default policies. Now, for future versions of OpenCL and SQL, like SQL 2.2, these restrictions will be less limited, and we may be able to implement the default parallel policies. Now, we can always have implementer-specific or standard-specific policies that allow you to do things with some restrictions. So one of the things you cannot do is you cannot just pass a pointer to a functor, because you just cannot do that because the hardware doesn't allow you to do it. Okay. So the data that we're using for this sort is a standard STD vector. Okay, and the parallel STL will convert this to the SQL buffers, and it will do all the operations, and it will give you data back, and everything will be sorted out. And what is hidden here is all the SQL things that allow you to create a device, to create a key, or all these things that you can always still do it. You can customize your policies, but this is the simplest way of using it. Okay, so it's very simple and just add the policy. Now, how does the SQL policy look like? You can construct a SQL policy with four arguments. That's what we saw. You can also construct a SQL policy with a queue, which means that you can enqueue different operations. You can combine your parallel arguments with SQL applications, and that means that you can do things in SQL and then do an accumulate and a reduce using the parallel STL. We have some samples about this. And you can also reuse the device selection. You can also allow for asynchronous operations and copybacks and all these kind of things. So now, there is a thing in SQL that is the kernel name. And because we have to, so SQL is a programming model that uses multiple compilers, we have to specify the name of the kernel. And the only way we can do it in different compilers is we create a type that is unique across both compilers. So the SQL policy takes a name in the case that you are using lambdas. And the reason is that these two calls to transform, which are the same call, but they take different lambdas, create two different kernels, and that means we need two separate names for them. So when you construct a transform, you need to specify the name of the kernel that you want to use. But it is only if you use lambdas. If you use normal C++ functors, you don't need to do this, okay? This is the ugly part, forget, eat it, take a beer, let's keep going. So you can use naming policies, that's how you do the name. So you can create different policies with different names, so you can reuse kernels, you can reuse programs, but the idea is that when you reuse the queue, and you enqueue here, you execute the transform, and the data is going to be copied into the device, it's going to be some operation, and it is going to be copied back when you get to the end of the transform. Now, because we integrate with SQL, we can do much more interesting stuff. So we can construct a SQL buffer from an STL container, okay? And then we can directly use this buffer into the SQL parallel STL. And that means that we don't have to copy the data in and out when we are in the call, but the data will be handled by the SQL runtime. And following the SQL rules, I don't want to get into detail, Peter will give us a talk later about how SQL works. That means that the operations will execute on the device asynchronously, and we will only have to worry about the data when we get at the end of the buffer and it will be copied back. Okay? So everything is implicit and is done by the runtime, and this looks like very nice simple class code. So you can go one step further and you may want to see, okay, I don't care about using an SDL container, I want to use a SQL buffer, but I need to access some data from a file, for example, that is on the host. So you can create a SQL buffer, you can create your SQL queue, and then you can just create what in SQL is called a host accessor that gives you access to some data on the host on the device. So you can access from data on the host from the device. That means that this operation that is going to be executed on the host will be accessing data using the fastest way possible according to the SQL implementation. So this SQL implementation has support for using things like NVLink or fast interconnects. It will use that meme to give you the data on the host. And when you get back to here, the SQL runtime guarantees that the data is going to be at the device, and that means that your transform will be executed on the device and will have all the information there. And when this thing finishes, data is back on the host and you keep going, okay? And I don't want to get into much more detail, but we have also done another policy, which is what we call the heterogeneous execution policy. And this has been done in collaboration with the University of Malaga. We have a high tech student, a PhD student working with us, and he created a policy that allows you to combine automatically work between CPU and GPU. And the only thing you have to do is to pass a percentage of work that you want to execute on the GPU, and that the SQL policy, or the heterogeneous SQL policy, will distribute the work between the CPU and the GPU automatically. And this is very easy to implement in SQL, because in SQL you have the same code for the CPU and the GPU, and the only thing you have to do is you create your SQL heterogeneous policy, you pass the two queues that you want to balance, you pass the ratio that you want on the second queue to have. So if the second queue is a GPU queue, you can say a 50%, so 50% of the work will execute on the GPU, and the other 50% will execute on the CPU, and then you just use your normal transform, and this is going to be executed combining the work items between the GPU and the CPU, and the data will go back on host, and you won't have to worry about CPU, GPU, or anything. Everything is handled automatically. So we have some results. We can discuss this offline if you are interested. But basically, if you don't use the SQL this heterogeneous policy, the runtime doesn't have all the information to execute things combined. So the execution is one kernel after the other. But if you use a heterogeneous SQL policy, which is very simple to implement, you can have both the GPU and the CPU running simultaneously, and you can get the result much faster. Okay. So this is how it looks like. I mean, it's just 5 lines of SQL code, and the only thing you have to do is balance the work between using iterators. So it's very simple to implement in C++. And you will have some results, and you can play around with the numbers, and you can get very nice performance results if you want. But let me just leave it there. If you're interested about this, we can talk offline. So some conclusions, PAR-SDL, it enables your developers to quickly exploit other architectures. So if you want to try something very quickly, use the PAR-SDL, you pass the policy, and it just works. SQL makes implementing these things very easy. So when you implement these policies in SQL, you do it once, and that's it. I mean, you can have multiple kernels if you want to have different performance portability, but everything is going to be C++ code, and you can just use some normal templates or runtime detection to choose which kernel you want to execute, but the interface is going to be almost the same. And in the case of CompuCVP, which is the implementation that I work for, we can execute on any OpenCL plus Spinify platform. So this runs out of the box in AMD GPUs, Intel CPU, or Intel GPU, for example. But in general, we work in any OpenCL implementation that has Spear support. For the heterogeneous execution, it's more experimental. So we are working on different policies. We're exploring how we can optimize the runtime to with different performance. But if you're interested about this, just contact us. That's me. Thank you. If you have any questions. Michael. Don't make difficult questions.
Probably a dumb question, but Do you use a different policy for CPU and GPU, or is it the same policy?
So not at the moment. Currently, we only have a SQL policy, and we are implementing all the algorithms in a way that kind of work for all of them. We are exploring exactly what to do. So one of the things we can do is to have different policies, so we can have a template specialization for a SQL policy for CPU and a SQL policy for GPU. But another thing we can do is that inside of the SQL policy, we can make that runtime detection and say we're executing a CPU, and then means to, I can choose to execute the CPU optimized kernel instead of the GPU one. Or I can detect if I'm executing a GPU, and then I make a random decision to choose which kernel I can execute. But we are discussing with the community to see what they think will be better. So I didn't say there, but if you want to get involved, there's a GitHub repo, and we are working openly there. We have students that are working in this. Ronan is helping us with his tricycle implementation. So we are really keen in having people contributing and giving us ideas on how to do, how to continue working. Any other question? No? Okay. Thank you.